looking at, I think that was Revelation 19, when he was talking about that the spirit, the testimony of Jesus Christ is actually the spirit of prophecy. Because when we talk about the book, we're actually talking about a person. Talking about the person, and like as you said, that the physical Bible we had is that's a relative, it's actually relative to the real one. Because if you look at all that the Holy Ghost penned down in the Bible, was actually the life of God that man expresses on the earth. That's what we found in the Bible. And each time we look at the Bible, if you look at the stories, there is no way you can actually, you know, be blessed. We have to look beyond the stories, because those men, they didn't just live by stories, they live by realities. They live by reality, meaning that something, it was like someone like Enoch would say that, that he had the testimony that he walked with God. He walked with, meaning that there was something that on a daily basis was actually was coming into the revelation of a being, a person, which is the book. And you know, if we talk about the Old Testament, you know, because sometimes I've seen people relating the Old Testament to, the Old Testament is actually that the book in a shadow. Because when you talk about Testament, there are two things that makes up the Testament, is the script, which is the revealed word, and which is the interpretation. There are two levels of interpretation. Now, for instance, you as a person, when the word of God is revealed to you, mean that you had understanding, then there's a place where you're interpreting it by speaking it. But God doesn't want us to end there. Our life can also interpret it. That's when you hear that word, spirit of prophecy. Is a testimony of Jesus Christ. Means that that prophecy means that you are living by that testimony. So that's how you are prophesying. It's not, it's beyond saying what you are saying. Maybe the Spirit came upon you by the, you know, operating the gift of the Spirit. That one is interpretation by nature. That is the nature of God, spending out the nature of God. You get the point? So when you look at what they call the Old Testament, the Old Testament are men that, are men that came into a life, which we call the life of the Spirit. Then they were able to interpret the life of God in a measure. You know, so that's what they call the Old Testament. Is not the do and don'ts. It's not the, as a matter of fact, that's what they call the shadow of the things to come. Now, as a matter, any New Testament, any, there is no way, all the, if you read the epistles, all of them, if you take time, you read the epistles, Paul, all of them had understanding about the New Testament. They understand the prophet, they understand the law. And you understand, now that was also when you hear the law of the Spirit, because you understand, you know, at the mountain on the transition, it's called that there are two things that appeared, the law and the prophet. It's not the law of Moses. That law is the same thing when you, when with regards to the book of Revelation, when he said the testimony and the spirit of the prophecy. Now what Moses represents the law. Moses also has the law and the spirit. But when you want to look at it in two ways, like when you say the word and the spirit, you get the point? The word himself would also have the spirit. With Jesus Christ, like when you say, okay, the Holy Ghost, the spirit, which is the Holy Ghost, then the Lord, which is Christ. The Christ also has the spirit. He also has the word. He also has the spirit. But in time to differentiate it, you get the point? You say the law and the spirit. So that nature, that what they call prophetic nature, there won't be a prophetic without the law. You get the point? The law is a revealed word. Then inside the word, you will find the life of the spirit. That's what they call prophetic life. You get the point? Which is the life that is in the flesh. You get the point? Which is the under what they call it, the blood. So the blood is the nature that is in the law, which is the testimony. So the spirit, by the word of the testimony. So the spirit is what they call the blood. So when you hear the spirit is what they call, don't you hear the blood of Jesus? Well, that's what they call nature, life of the spirit. That blood is the nature. You get the point? Mean that the blood that blood resides in the flesh. That flesh is also spirit. You get the point? So when we talks about the book is a testimony. Meaning that anyone that has the book, you will testify about the book. If you have the book, you will testify about the book. Meaning that the testimony is actually the life of the book. What is the will of the book? What is the book is saying? Again, what is actually the you know, for instance, you know, just like what Pastor Clef was actually linked to when he was talking about a prophetic church. When we talk about a prophetic church, now because if you look at that, if you look at the Old Testament, look at the picture of the Old Testament. Now you know Hebrew chapter 1 tells us that in time past the Lord speak in diverse manners through the prophet. Is it the same way? Anytime God speaks through the prophet. In the New Testament also, all of those guys in the New, all of them are prophets. Because see, you can't speak the word of God if you are not a prophet. The other one, if you are not a prophet, it is not possible for you to speak the word of God. Because now, you see in that place that we read, in that John 3, that we read, he said, there is no one that will testify about God if you have not heard the word of God. Like when he was talking about, he was talking about John, that he that speaketh that earthly things there is not the carnal things. Because it's not the carnal thing. He's talking about the realm of the living soul. Yes. That realm of the living soul is the realm they call earthly things. Yes. It's not carnal thing. Now, I want to say this. You see, there are, if you study the Bible carefully, you discover that in the New Testament, watch all of those guys in the New Testament and in the Old Testament. Now, in the Old Testament, you can liken the Old Testament, like the Old Testament, you can liken them to the meek of the world. If you want to look at it in that area, then you look at the New Testament as the meat of the world. Are you what I'm saying? Because the meat of the world speaks of perfection. But now, for we to actually fully enter the New Testament, you must be a living soul. Now, all of those living souls, they don't walk. Their own is not to confess to the word of God. To the, you know, I understand that. That's why. In this New Testament, is something that every teachers, every pastors must be balanced. God will help. There are signs that God will take it through because of the members, because of the people. You understand? For instance, now, if you don't understand, if you have not, you don't understand, a minister doesn't understand things that has to do with your new bed. A minister doesn't understand, you know, standing point, things that has to do with, you know, how to confess God's word to oversight things. You know, there are class of people you will meet. You get the point? That you need to take them through that, you need to take them through that process. You need to take them through that process. When you begin to mature them. But when you look at the New Testament, you see, the meek of the New Testament is a living soul. You get it? When you begin to mature, because all of them that are living, when you talk about, there are meat of the meek. Yes.
which is Paul. Paul and Peter begin to talk about Peter begin to. That's why there's a connection between that sincere make to priesthood. You know, because what? There are beginning of the priesthood who started at that court. There are also sons of Aaron who stand in the holy place. That Aaron himself who started the most holy place. So immediately you begin to start with the journey of perfection. You get the point? You begin to enter the place of priesthood. You start, even those, all of those guys in the Old Testament, all of them are priests. Because what makes all priests? Priest is also a prophet. You understand the point? What is a priest? Priest simply means a separation from, you have been separated from a normal life. From the natural life. So it means that, you know, in this end time, as we begin to, as God begins to bring me to us, one of the things God is going to culture also is actually that living soul. When you walk with the power of heavens, when angels, you understand our activities of angels. You know, sometimes in the church, I wonder when you talk about the angels, you are the angel is here. You know, some people are still far from that realm. But you see, this living, all of those living souls, they had understanding of these angels. They knew the angel that walked with them. I was so amazing when a woman of God came to our church one side, and then he was talking about, he picked it, he was talking about angels, he was talking about their classes, this one. You know, these are the things we are going to be seeing in these end times. You understand the point? When you have certain encounter of angels, you understand their works, you understand what they came to do. You understand what they came to do. We are going to be coming into this experience before we begin to enter the New Testament. Now, the New Testament, you can't enter the New Testament if you don't have life.
Sure.
Now, look at it. In the holy place, you can't access the holy place without you becoming an altar. You see, all those things you see in the altar court, they are being so. You see that daughter of bronze. They are being. Those are statues. You get the point? Those things are beings. They are not just so, because all those things are just, all those things are the prototype. All of them are beings. All of them are beings. When you talk, I mean that you can't be laid as a sacrifice if you are not an altar. It's a place where they burn incense. So if you are not an altar, you are not qualified to enter the holy place, the most holy place. Because now at every level, if you look at the holy place, what entered the most holy place is a life. Eh? It is a life of the most holy place. Because if you look at the altar of brass, Paul began to refer that altar of brass in the Hebrew 9 as the most holy place. Because that altar of brass is actually a life that will enter into the most holy place. Because for you to enter into the most holy place, you mean that you become an altar of incense. You see that incense, see what it burns. There's nothing like darkness in it. That of the altar court had a kind of darkness that is in it. But you see that author of us in the book of Revelation call it the prayer of saints.
Yes.
You know, that is not for everybody. It means that you've been able to come into a level of separation that you see that smoke is white. It has no darkness in it. You see that incense, when they burn it, it's purely white. It has no altar. It means that there's no darkness again. Because the holy place is a place when they say, you strong man, you young man, you've actually overcome the wicked one. You get the point? So for you to see God, you have no any darkness in you.
Yes, sir.
You know, but you have no any. So one of the things we'll be seeing in this end time are men of living soul, men that have life. You get the point? So, because they have life, and they don't understand how to walk with the power of heavens.
Hallelujah.
Because, you understand that outer court only place is also speaks of heavens. Now, when you understand it, I see in the book of Hosea, Hosea chapter 6 begin to talk about, can we see that Hosea chapter 6? At least... Hosea chapter 6, that's Hosea chapter 6.
Yes.
From verse 1.
Let us return unto the Lord.
Come, let us return unto the Lord.
For he has torn.
He has torn.
And he will heal us.
He will heal us. So you see the place of healing. That place of turning is a place of the outer court. Now, what is that turning? That turning means that you are no longer seeking for earthly things. You're no longer seeking earthly life. That's what it means to turn. It's a beginning to perfection. Meaning that you began the journey of perfection. Uh-huh, continue.
He has smitten.
Mm-hmm.
And he will bind us up.
He will bind us up.
After 2 days.
You see it? Now look at it. He said it will bind us up. You see that binding up is the end of the outer court. That is the Son of Man. Now, if we turn, it will, that would bind us up. Is what Jesus began to talk about. He said, now their eye is single. Because now that it means that their eye is single. Because you see, when we talk about singing of eye, that's why we talk about the New Testament. Our eye is not single yet. Right, we need to interact with certain light that will bring our eye into what. Because when a mind eye is single, it means that if you look at that scripture, compare it to Hebrews chapter 11. He described that those men that their eyes were single, they said they were worried worthy of them. Satan can't bribe them with anything. You can't, they're higher than the world. Because the thing that we need to overcome in the New Testament, the things of the world, which is the wisdom of Satan, the nature of Satan that is in the soul. But for you to begin that journey, something must happen. You must turn. Uh-huh.
After 2 days,
will
he revive us?
He will revive us. Now you see the after 2 days talking about there. The 2 days speaks of the holy place.
Yes.
The 2 days speaks of the holy place. It's after 2 days he will revive us. That word revive means that it will change us. It will alter us. Eh? That now it's not a minister of gospel normally said to us that. When he's talking about revival here, he's not talking about to do, our normal thing that we are doing in the church. He's just coming to revive it. So no, that revival here is a new thing. When he here, I will do a new thing. And on that place, they call it also, it's a wilderness. It's a life of the wilderness. Because immediately you begin to, that wilderness is not a life of man. It's never a life of man. It's a life of God. Is a place when we begin to encounter God. Continue.
In the third day, He will raise us up.
It will raise us up.
And we shall live in His sight.
You see it? You see it now? That His sight is actually the most holy place. The most holy place where the place they call resurrection. That is a place of resurrection, which is the place of the kingdom. He said, we will not live in His sight. He said, we will live in His sight. Then continue.
Then shall we know.
Uh-huh.
If we follow on to know the Lord.
Mm-hmm. Continue.
His going forth is prepared mm-hmm. at the morning.
Mm-hmm.
And it shall come unto us at the rain.
Mm-hmm.
At the latter and former rain.
Now, you see, they have left that place. Now, that from the chapter 1 and chapter 2 tell us the essence of what this former and the latter rain will do. But the chapter 1 does give us the summary. Again, then chapter, is it chapter 2 you are reading?
Chapter 3
begin to give us the process.
Verse 3.
Because at the same time, both the latter and the former rain is doing together.
That's true.
Uh-huh, continue.
As the latter and former rain
mm-hmm.
unto the earth.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 4.
Mm-hmm.
O Ephraim.
Praise God. I think we'll stop there. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now what I'm trying to say is that, you see, the essence of the question you ask, things that has to do with that book.
Mm-hmm.
That book is actually a prophecy.
Yes.
That book is actually a person. So it means that if the church as pastors, because see, the truth of matter, one thing I've discovered about the New Testament is that
Pastor Clef said earlier on, that if you don't as a minister, you can't give what you don't have. For any minister to actually minister the New Testament, it means that you must see the New Testament. I mean that you must see it. Because if you don't see it, a minister is like, you know, that book of, is in the book of, is it Habakkuk? When he said, I will stand upon my watch.
Yeah.
Mm. Mm. I will stand upon my watch. It means that there's a place that a minister is standing to see what is the will of God. It means that, because the essence of that Habakkuk is that, is to actually tell the people there are danger ahead. You get the point? There are danger ahead, that it's just like when you say the name of the Lord is a strong tower. So the responsibility of that a pastor is to build the name of the Lord, that when people will run into it and they will be saved. So you're able to see certain danger ahead. There's something you are seeing ahead, and that is what you are trying to let the people see, so whereby they can be able to escape. So a minister that is not seeing it can't minister it. If you don't see, because not seeing it is that you know the effect. You understand the reason. You know what? Because when a man don't understand the reason for life, you can't. There's no way you play. Even when you are hearing life, even when in a place where the thing is being played, you will toy with it. You will play with it. You won't know the butter. I was ministering in church yesterday. I told them. I said even when I leave now. I said, the things I'm saying to you now, you may not understand. But if, assuming that I died now, and most of you begin to come into understanding, you understand the reason, you understand what I'm trying to communicate. There is no safety here. You see, here, this is actually the trap of Satan. This is a net of Satan. So the danger of it is that if a minister begins to point the people to this system, the minister don't understand the danger. You get the point? Because the same we are in here, if there's any time a man should fear God, is now. If there's any time we should run to God, is now. Because what? Because what is that? Gross darkness ahead of us. And the safety is actually God. There's no any place, nowhere. The safety is in God. So if you as a minister have not seen it, it's very difficult for you to point the people to it. Because seeing it is actually is, the more you, the as you see it, the more you are crying for it. As you see, just like what Pastor Claire said, that the more you see, the more you are seeing your helplessness. The more you are seeing your, he said, that's what he said in the book of 1 John. He said, if you say you have no sin, it means you have not seen the truth. That's what he trying to say. If you say you have no sin, it means that you have not seen the truth. Because the minute truth is revealed to you, truth will make you to see your state. That's what truth does. You will know that when Jesus said, without him, you can do nothing. Indeed, without him, you can do nothing. So we need to run to that book. We need to run to that testament. Yes, yeah. It's our safety. Yeah. He said, the name of the Lord. That name is also a person. It's a person. It's a book.
Yeah, it's a book.
He said, we need to run to it.
Yeah.
He said, but when we run to it, then that place lies our safety. Yeah. Amen. I pray that God will help us.
Yeah.
And God will help us in this season. It will help us that we walk with him. In Jesus' name.